This is the second video on birth processes. So we're now going to turn to section 3.3 in the notes. This is about explosion. So there are two phenomena which may arise in the setting of birth processes which cannot happen for a Poisson process. So the first of these is absorption. So if it happens that our birth rates, lambda 0, lambda 1, and so on, remember that lambda I is the birth rate in state I, so if there are I individuals present. So if it happens that lambda 0, lambda 1, up to lambda n minus 1 are all strictly positive, but that lambda n is equal to 0 for some value n greater than or equal to 0, then assuming that we start with an initial state which is less than or equal to n, then the birth process is eventually going to get stuck at population size n. So I'm going to interpret exp of 0, so the exponential distribution with parameter 0, as simply being almost surely infinite. So this isn't completely absurd from the modelling perspective. So imagine the situation where there's a finite amount of space or there are a finite amount of resources for the population, beyond which point it's impossible for individuals to reproduce. So in that case, it might make sense to have lambda n be 0 from that point on. So you've encountered this phenomenon of absorption in the setting of discrete time Markov chains already. The second phenomenon, which you've not come across before, is that of explosion. So if the rates lambda n increase too quickly, it may in fact happen that infinitely many individuals are born in a finite period of time. So obviously this is not desirable as a feature of a model. There are no real-world populations which are actually infinite. So it's useful from the modelling perspective to know for which models the explosion cannot occur and restrict our attention to those. So let's give a formal definition. So consider a simple birth process X, which as usual has rates lambda n, n greater than or equal to 0, which we start from some state k in the naturals. And let's let tn be the first time that our process hits the level n plus k. So let's now let t infinity be the limit of these times tn. So this is an increasing sequence, and I'm going to allow my limit to take the value infinity. So this is an increasing sequence, which then necessarily possesses a limit. And I could also write that limit as the sum from 1 to infinity of the holding time zi. So then we say that explosion is possible if t infinity is finite with strictly positive probability. Okay, so if t infinity is finite, that means we've had infinitely many births in finite time. There turns out to be a simple criterion in the context of birth processes for whether explosion is possible or not. And in fact, there's a dichotomy. So either explosion occurs with probability 1 or it occurs with probability 0. And here are the criteria. So we're starting in state k. So if it's the situation that the sum of the reciprocals of the birth rates is finite, then the probability that t infinity is finite is 1. So in other words, explosion occurs with probability 1. If, on the other hand, the sum of those reciprocals is infinite, then the probability that t infinity is infinity is 1. So in other words, the probability that explosion occurs, because that's the complementary event, is 0. So let's prove this. So leave the statement of the theorem up. So I'm going to assume, without loss of generality, that k equals 0, because otherwise all I have to do is just shift the indices. So suppose we log that k equals 0, otherwise just shift the indices. Okay, so for A, let's have a look at the expectation of this random variable t infinity, which could potentially be infinite. So this is the same as the expectation of the sum from 1 to infinity of zi. So these are non-negative random variables, so by Tonelli's theorem, I can in fact interchange the expectation and the sum. And zi is an exponential random variable with the parameter lambda I minus 1. And so it has mean 1 on lambda I minus 1. Okay, so let me write that with a nicer index as 1 on lambda I. Okay, so since this series is by assumption in part A, so here we're assuming that the series is finite. So since this series is finite, that tells us that the expectation of T infinity is also finite. So expectation T infinity is finite since the series is. But if a random variable has finite expectation, then certainly it is finite almost surely. So this implies that the probability that T infinity is finite is 1, which is what we claimed. Okay. So for part B, let's note first that P T infinity is finite is 0 if and only if the probability that T infinity is infinity is 1, so just because they're complementary events. And the latter is implied by the expectation of e to the minus t infinity being 0. So if the probability that t infinity is infinity is 1, then the expectation of e to the minus t infinity is 0. And we're going to use this as a criterion. Okay, so for any n, we have that the expectation e to the minus t infinity is going to be less than or equal to the expectation of minus the sum up to n only of the random variable zi. And that's simply because I've made the sum smaller, and so I've made e to the minus the sum bigger. Okay, and this is just a sum of independent random variables, and so this is equal to the product of the expectations of the individual terms, like this. Okay, and what you can see here is just the moment generating function of the random variable zi, but evaluated at the parameter minus 1. So this is the MGF of zi. So say expectation of e to the theta zi evaluated at theta equals minus 1. So if you remember your MGFs, you'll remember that this quantity here, let me do it with the index I plus 1, this is equal to lambda I on lambda I plus 1, which I'm going to write as 1 plus 1 on lambda I to the minus 1. Okay, so if we now take logarithms on both sides of this expression, what we get is that minus log of the expectation of e to the minus t infinity is bounded below by the sum from I equals 0 to n minus 1. So I've got a quantity to the power minus 1 here. So when I take minus the log, the minuses are going to cancel, and I'm going to get just the log of 1 plus 1 lambda I. You might wonder why the indices between z and lambda I are off by one against one another, and that's because we're starting in state 0. So the first holding time, z1, has rate lambda 0, and so on and so forth. Okay, so since this inequality holds for every n, I can take the limit in n.
we get that minus the log of expectation of e to the minus t infinity is bounded below by the sum to infinity of these things. And now I'm going to do a split into two different cases. So let's first think about the case where we have that lambda I is less than or equal to 1 for infinitely many values of I. So if lambda I is less than or equal to 1 for infinitely many values of I, so then if lambda I is less than or equal to 1, then 1 on lambda I is greater than or equal to 1. And so that means that we have infinitely many terms in this sum, which are bounded below by log 2, so that's certainly going to be infinite. Then clearly, the right-hand side is infinite. If, on the other hand, lambda I is bigger than 1 for all sufficiently large values of I, sufficiently large I, let's say I greater than or equal to some index capital I, then we have, and you can check this inequality, that the log of 1 on 1 plus lambda I is greater than or equal to simply log 2 divided by lambda I. Okay, and that's for all I greater than or equal to capital I. So then we have that minus this log, the expectation e to the minus t infinity, if I only look at the terms which are bigger than capital I make things smaller. So this is I greater than or equal to capital I log 2 divided by lambda I. And since we've omitted only finitely many terms from the original sum, if the original sum is infinite, then so must this one be. And since we have omitted only finitely many terms, from the sum equals 0 to infinity, 1 on lambda I, which is infinite, then the right-hand side must also be infinite. So that tells us that the expectation e to the minus t infinity is indeed 0, as we wanted. Okay, so let me just go back to the statement. We have a clear dichotomy here between explosion occurring with probability 1 and explosion occurring with probability 0. So notice that what this boils down to is that a sum of independent exponential random variables is finite if and only if its mean is finite. Let me emphasize that this is not true in general. This is something special about exponential random variables, and the independence is crucial. So normally, finiteness of the expectation does imply finiteness of the random variable, but the converse is not true. Okay, so I want to finish this video with a quick recap on branching processes. So this is something you saw in prelims probability. So this was a different model for a growing population, but in that context, in discrete time. So in that setting, we have individuals, each of which live for a unit time, and then just before dying, they give birth to a random number of children distributed according to something called the offspring distribution. And then different individuals reproduce independently in the same manner as their parent. So let's let Pn be the size of the population in generation n. So then the process Pn, now indexed by a discrete index n, is called a branching process. So let me just remind you of some facts about branching processes. So let's let n be a random variable, generic random variable with the offspring distribution. And let's write g of s for its probability generating function. And I'm going to suppose, just to exclude degenerate cases, that the mean of this random variable is finite and that the probability that n is at least 2 is strictly positive. And let me suppose also that we start from a population consisting of a single individual. So then we saw in prelims that the generating function of the population in generation n, so that's the expectation of s to the power of pn, so that can be written as the n-fold composition of the probability generating function associated with the offspring distribution just with itself. So we compose the probability generating function of n with itself n times. And we also saw that the probability, which we're going to call q, that the population ever goes extinct, is given by the minimal non-negative solution to the equation s equals g of s, where again g of s is the probability generating function of the offspring distribution. And we also saw a very nice fact, another dichotomy, that if the mean of the offspring distribution is at most 1, then the population goes extinct with probability 1. And if mu is strictly greater than 1, then the probability of extinction is strictly less than 1. So in other words, there's positive probability that the population does not die out. And you'll see a continuous time version of a branching process on problem sheet 1. So we've now completed all of the material that you need in order to attempt the first problem sheet. And in the next video, I'll move on to continuous time Markov chains.